Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
In the week that I think we will look back and call the Sam Bennett week, we come off a week of two Flames games where the Flames have one regulation win and one shootout loss. And as usual, I'm Dan alongside Matt. How you feeling, Matt?
Good. Nice to see Sam Bennett get the monkey off his back.
Yeah, well, let's get there. Let's break down our games this week. And I guess the first one being the Florida game, we'll be talking about Sam Bennett. You and I were both live at this game. I don't know about you, but going into the game, I wasn't really sure what to expect. I was a little bit worried because Florida's been a hot team recently, and I thought that they might be a tough team to beat. But less than a minute into the game, the Flames scored, and Sam Bennett got his seventh of the year, and they just kept scoring.
Yeah, and it was interesting with Florida that they were on a 12-game winning streak that which ended the game prior. But I watched a couple of the games towards the end of their streak, and you could tell that some bad habits were starting to creep into their game. I just was not sure if they were going to be able to bounce back for the game against Calgary or not, and they didn't even play whatsoever.
No, and, you know, looking at the goalies there, I would have thought that Montoya started, like, you know, they had Roberto Luongo in net, and he, I guess, you know, as per Luongo's usual MO, he's, you know, really streaky. He looks great one game and like crap the next. And in that game, he just looked like crap.
Yeah. Well, I can't really blame him on any of the goals, really. The whole Panthers team in front of him played really terribly. Like, you can't, like, on the first Bennett goal, that was just a quick slap shot from in close. He couldn't react. Then the Gaudreau goal, that was a bad play by Huberdeau. The second Bennett goal, that one was more a fluke play because Bennett was trying to drag the puck onto the backhand and he lost control of it and it just found a hole in Luongo, and the third one was just a quick rebound thing where Luongo did not have any opportunity to get into a position to stop it. So as much as it's not good to surrender four goals in one period, I can't really fault the goalie on any of them. It sometimes you have a bad game, bad luck in a game, and everything seems to go in, and that was the case.
Not only did Bennett get a hat trick in this game, plus one, he got it in the first period, and three goals right, you know, in the first 20 minutes. That makes him the youngest player in Flames history to score a hat trick. His age at the time was 19 years and 207 days.
He's actually the third youngest player in NHL history to score four goals. Only one guy in 1943 and one guy in 1982 were younger.
So the youngest guy of the modern era.
Mm-hmm.
So Matt, if I told you that this puts Bennett on a list of only six Flames rookies who've had a hat trick, who would you think would be on that list with him?
Nieuwendyk, Yuri Herdina, Gaudreau, obviously, from last year. Sergei Makarov, possibly. I'll go with Theo Fleury and Gary Roberts.
You got two of them right. The other guys on that list are Joe Nieuwendyk, Brett Hull, Matthew Lombardi, Josh Juris, and Johnny Gaudreau.
Huh.
So interesting that three of those six are still with the team, Juris, Gaudreau, and Bennett. And, I mean, you know, Joe Nieuwendyk, I think, is fairly obvious. Brett Hull, I always forget that guy was a Flame.
Yeah.
And Matthew Lombardi, that must have, well, he looked pretty good in his rookie year. But, you know, not a guy you would really expect to be on that list.
No. Well, I don't think many people, like, if you flash forward 10 or 15 years, I don't think anybody would think Josh Juris would be on that list either.
No, but if we look at the rookie year that Juris had last year, it makes sense.
Oh, definitely. But not one of those players that would stand out in that manner.
No. Well, maybe he and Lombardi will both sort of be the forgotten guys on that list.
Mm-hmm.
So, good game. I was pleased to see that Mason Raymond picked up a goal and Dougie Hamilton picked up an assist. Good to see, you know, that was Raymond's fourth goal of the year and Hamilton's 11th assist of the season and his 10th assist. He got one on the first and second Bennett goals.
Yeah, so, I only lament that Jonathan Huberdeau got his stick on that Gaudreau pass, for which ended up being Gaudreau's goal, because if he didn't, that puck would have landed on Sam Bennett's stick and likely would have been a 5-goal night. So he cost somebody $1 million.
In the Safeway score and win contest, yeah. Yeah, they did an article talking to Sam Bennett in the paper about that, and he said that he wasn't aware that someone would have won $1 million if he scored 5 goals. You got to bet the people at Safeway were sitting there freaking out near the end.
Oh, yeah, especially after one period. It's like, oh, no.
Yeah, well, that's it. And then in the third, after he got the last goal, it's like, oh, crap, okay, we might almost be done here. We might get away with this.
Mm-hmm.
But even after that fourth goal, there was at least one more chance where he looked like he'd have a good one. And a couple times in the second, he looked like he'd have one, too. And with all of that, I mean, if we take a look at that game, overall, you know, I agree with you that Florida wasn't playing as well as they could as a team, but I don't think we can say that this was all Florida not playing well. We have to give credit, I think, to the Flames. They played a really good offensive game.
Oh, for sure. Calgary dictated the play from the puck drop at the beginning of the game right through to the final whistle. And they didn't really allow Florida any chances to even pick themselves up from the mat at all. Even in the third period, in the last 5 minutes, when Florida was trying to break Hiller's shutout, they still kept them to the sides and didn't allow any traffic in front or any particularly dangerous chances.
You mentioned Hiller. That was another thing I was worried about going into this game. When I heard that Hiller was back in net and Ramo was getting the night off, I thought, oh, with the way that Florida's been playing, they might light Hiller up. And I thought that Hiller looked quite good in this game. I mean, you can tell he hasn't played for a while, but he looked like a guy who really wants to earn that crease back.
Well, you have to look at it from his perspective. This might be his last shot at salvaging his NHL career at, because if he did not play well and just remained the once every 10 game backup, I don't see any team signing him next year, and he'd be off to either Russia or Sweden or something next year. So he needs to play well in order to say, hey, I'm still a good goalie. So, you know, he gets a contract next year.
Yeah, I think you're right. I mean, if you want to, you know, a guy who plays once every 10 games or 8 games a year, pretty much, you can easily find that in your AHL team. There's no point in going and signing a big money goalie like Hiller.
No, and especially a guy that's going to be wanting $2+ million just to be a backup. Like, you can use that financial asset better.
Mm-hmm.
If he's struggling still. So the fact that he had a good game not only against Florida but also against Edmonton, that will help him, especially moving forward next season.
Yeah, and I mean, Hiller didn't get tested a lot in the Florida game. He only got 15 shots on him. But, you know, I think that's apt for a guy who's coming back after not playing in 20-some games, that it sort of let him work his way back in. But yeah, I was surprised to see that he didn't have a lot of rust on him, and maybe that's the sign of a true veteran professional, that he can keep himself in good shape, but he looked better out there than I thought he would.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I agree. Especially when he came into the game with like a 3.7 goals against average and an 860 save percentage. You're not really going to have too high of expectations, so he definitely exceeded it, and actually came close to tying the Flames record for longest shutout streak.
Yeah, no, that's crazy. Hiller's been out for a month. Ramos held the net pretty much a whole month then, from, you know, December, early December, about the, you know, yeah, it was the 12th against New York. And no wonder Ramo's getting tired, you know. I mean, it's January 13th when they finally took him out of the Nets. That's a month he's been playing nonstop.
Yeah. Well, and I'm glad that the Flames gave him a rest. He's been having dehydration issues as well. So, between some minor injuries and general fatigue, it's good to see him get a bit of a break.
Yeah, well, I think I'd be having fatigue if I was playing and practicing that much, you know. I mean, as a goalie, you're out there the whole game and you're working really hard. It doesn't surprise me he's starting to have some health issues.
Mm-hmm.
And then the next game, the Flames went to Edmonton to start a road trip. The Florida game was the last game of a homestand, and now we're on a 5-game road trip. And I guess you wouldn't really call Edmonton that much of a road trip, but it's still on the road. And the Flames started this one off with an early goal from Bennett, his 11th of the season, and ended up losing 2-1 in a shootout. Any thoughts overall yet on this game, Matt?
As soon as the Flames got through the first period and the power play to start the second period, I was very concerned that the Flames would take their foot off the gas. They only managed to capitalize once, and Talbot did rob several Flames players between Monahan and Brody. It just made it, you wonder if the Flames were going to just pack it in. It's sort of like the Colorado game earlier in the month, where the Flames had all sorts of good chances and struggled before finally breaking through. I was a little concerned that they were going to sit back in that game and against Edmonton, and unfortunately the Flames didn't get their second good bounce like they did against Colorado and ended up surrendering that goal in the third period and falling ultimately in the shootout.
Yeah, and both teams had lots of shots. Edmonton had 27 shots, which means 37 shots, which means 36 were saved by Hiller. And the Flames took 32 shots, 31 of them saved by Talbot. When I look at this game, I think that Talbot really saved the Oilers. I think that he was standing on his head all night, and if it wasn't him, if it was another goaltender, or if he didn't look as good, I think the Flames could have run the score up more than they did.
Oh, for sure. Like, if he doesn't make that great glove save on TJ Brody in the first period, the Flames probably win that game 4-5-0.
Yeah. And like you said, the Flames were trying, and I think that they were just getting frustrated. I don't know if it was necessarily taking their foot off the gas, but I think they were just getting frustrated by Talbot.
Yeah. And that's one of the reasons why the Flames are the fifth worst team in the NHL this year. There's no consistency from even period to period or game to game. For as good as they looked against Florida, they looked mighty terrible in the second and third periods against Edmonton.
Yeah, they did. We saw Michael Frolik back in this game after his injury, and that meant that Jari Hudler was scratched. He's apparently hurt again. What did you think of what we saw from Frolik?
No different from any of the other games we've seen from him. You wouldn't even know he was hurt. That's how constant he was from prior to the game, his injury, to his first game back.
You know, one thing I'm liking about Frolik is he seems to be able to click with whoever Hartley puts him on the ice with. He just has a style, I guess, that he's looking good with anybody. And I agree with you. I wouldn't have known he was gone. Like, he just looked great out there. He had 15 minutes and 37 seconds of ice time. And again, sort of new line mates, a new line he hasn't been with. And, you know, he looked great.
Yeah, he had quite a few good chances himself. And he was another one of those players that fell victim to being robbed by Talbot. It is what it is. And
he did get the assist on the Bennett goal, though.
Yeah, and if he can continue to play well, then that will help the Flames get some secondary scoring depth that they've been missing since he went down.
Yeah, no, that's true, and I think that's one of the things that they have been lacking is that secondary scoring, and now that it looks like they're not putting Frolik on line one, at least for now, it'll help bring some of that to line two. You mentioned how Frolik, you know, was one of the victims of Cam Talbot. Interesting if you look at the shots in the Edmonton game for Calgary. Frolik had 4 shots, Bennett had 4 shots, and Backlund had 4 shots. Gudra had 3, so, you know, a lot of the guys, Monahan 3, Bolig had 1 shot, but yeah, Granlund had none, which I find kind of funny. But the guys that were expecting to be the shooters, those top 6, are really the guys that were getting the shots in there. And, you know, even Brody had 3 shots. So, yeah, you got to give huge amounts of credit to Talbot in this one.
Mm-hmm.
And really, I mean, it's funny that he inked his extension right after this game, but I would have signed him again after that, too.
Hey, you beat Calgary. Here's $15 million.
we won a game. Here you go. I just worry. I mean, Talbot obviously has some talent, and I'm worried he's going to be another one of these Oilers goalies that, you know, just kind of toils away in Edmonton and perhaps isn't being used to the best of his ability.
Well, the problem with Edmonton, they're treating the symptom, which is bad goaltending. They're not actually treating the cause, which is inept defense.
Yeah, you're right.
And, like, if you look at their defensive core, like, the only guy that's a legitimate top 4 guy is Darnell Nurse. Arguably Oscar Klefbom as well. The rest of the guys are borderline at best, and it's not really surprising that they're once again one of the worst teams in the league.
Well, it's interesting because, you know, the rumor came out this week that the Oilers had the chance to trade Ryan Nugent-Hopkins for Seth Jones. And if I was Peter Chiarelli, I would have jumped on that. That would give me at least a top 2 defenseman.
Apparently, Nashville, they turned down that offer, and they instead asked for Leon Draisaitl instead. And honestly, if I was Edmonton, even though, yeah, Draisaitl's having a good year, I think I still would have pulled the trigger on that.
Yeah, I think of the two, Nugent Hopkins, Draisaitl, Nugent Hopkins still has the better upside.
Yeah, and you can't trust the 20-game hot streak, because Draisaitl, since he exploded on the scene, has not really scored that much. I think he only has like 3 goals in his last 15 or so games, and you just don't know exactly what you have there. And with Nugent Hopkins, you know at least he's a good second line center. And with them having McDavid as well, that's an area of strength for the Oilers. So even though it would have been...
Yeah, I would have done it 1-for-1. I would have done Draisaitl for Seth Jones if I was Edmonton.
I don't know. Edmonton seems hesitant to pay the proper price tag for legitimate talent. Like, if you look at the draft last year, they could have had Dougie Hamilton. They did offer slightly more than what the Flames did, but instead of throwing in an additional asset just to throw it over the top, the Bruins traded him to Calgary, and instead they used 2 of those assets to go and acquire Griffin Reinhart, who has struggled and not looked like an NHL caliber player. And with them not getting Seth Jones, now their options, they're not likely going to get another first pairing defenseman that's young, because how often do those guys come available? So now they're going to have to settle for a guy like maybe Travis Hamonic, which that's okay, but that doesn't...
Hamonic doesn't lead you through a rebuild.
You need like a TJ Brody or a Dougie Hamilton or somebody that's a legitimate number 1 or number 2 defenseman.
I think Hamilton just puts you in a younger Andrew Ferentz position, which they've already been in.
Mm-hmm.
Having that sort of veteran guy who's good enough, but you still need better.
And
so, yeah, I don't know. It seems like the Oilers just don't want to pay a price. Like, you know, they've got talent, but it seems like they don't realize that you got to give something to get something.
Yeah, and it seems like they're looking for bargains instead of just paying the price tag that it will cost to get the legitimately good talent.
Which, it's interesting they still have that mentality with Chiarelli in power, because when Chiarelli was in Boston, he was pretty good about paying what it took to get the talent you needed. So you wonder if it is a symptomatic problem with higher-ups in the organization.
Mm-hmm. Well, we'll see. Like, apparently Nugent Hopkins is still on the trading block, and if he does get dealt, it'll be interesting to see what for, because I don't see anyone trading anyone that's even in the same caliber of player as Jones for Nugent Hopkins.
No, I don't either.
But we'll see.
Looking at that trade and the other ones that have happened, you think that we had the trade deadline this past week. Are you surprised that we've had so much activity in the last 7, 10 days, whatever it's been?
Well, not really. Usually teams are hesitant to pull deals in the first couple months just because of the cap hits and all that stuff. And now that it's into the new year, teams are looking, okay, well, I need this, this, or that, and would rather have the player on their team for a longer period of time instead of, like, a month. So it doesn't really surprise me. Usually there's a couple of trades that go down in the early part of January. Usually not too many, but not nearly as many as there have been this.
We've had 9 trades since the 6th of January.
Yeah. Usually it's like 2 or 3, maybe 4, but yeah.
Yeah.
It's been a little frantic.
And they haven't all been big moves, but there's been some well-known names, you know, like the Cavalier deal. I don't think is that big of a move. Everyone understands why it's being done, but you know, the Cavalier is a big name. Tokarski moving, that was a bigger one. Emerson Edom moving. So I think it's just one of these things that, you know, names people know, and obviously the John Scott deal is getting a huge amount of press, but you know, it's not like we've seen the blockbusters yet, and we haven't seen anybody really trading rentals. It's all been, you know, trading for depth need.
Yeah. The only true blockbuster was the Jones-Johansson deal.
Yeah, that's true. But even then, I would say I think it's partly a big deal because of when it is, too. If that was a deadline day deal, I don't know that it would have got as much press as it did.
Possibly.
It might. It would depend what else was done. But I think it's just a huge deal because of when it was done during the year.
Yeah. Well, I think that another reason why you're seeing so many deals is due to the fact that there are so many teams that are potentially playoff caliber teams, so that they might be more apt to make a deal just to see if the new guy can push them over the top.
Yeah, and that's what a lot of these look like. You know, it's like trading a forward for a defenseman. It's like, hey, we need an extra defenseman, you know, so we're just going to make a trade for a similar player.
And it's one of those situations that if they struggle afterwards and are out of the playoffs by the time the actual deadline comes, that they couldn't just turn around and sell that player or other players on their team.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, why not try? You got an extra month and a half to figure it out.
Yeah.
So why not see if you can, that guy will spark your team to new heights or...
Yeah, well, even, you know, something like the Bartley for Elliott deal, you know, defenseman for defenseman, Scott and Bartley for Tenorti and Fournier, you know, defenseman forward for defenseman forward. It's changing like pieces, you know, Allen for Mullen. It's saying, okay, we have a forward, a centerman, and we need either a defenseman or we just want to, like you said, try another forward and see if it makes any difference. But we're not seeing anyone in selling mode yet. These are all hockey deals we're seeing.
Mm-hmm. And we'll see, like, especially, like, a team like Calgary falls out of it where they're, like, 7 or 8 points out of a playoff spot. I could see Calgary getting an early start on dealing this, that, or the next thing just because why not?
Yeah, and I can see some GMs wanting to make a better deal just to try and get that player before their competitor. You know, you've got someone like Vancouver who, you know, might want, or even someone in the East, let's say, because if we don't want to trade, you know, with Vancouver, we can avoid it. But somebody like Pittsburgh or New Jersey who might be willing to pay a little bit more to get the deal done early.
Yeah. And we'll see. Like everything, we just have to wait until we get a little closer to the actual deadline to see what direction this team will take. Because right now, we're 5 points out of a playoff spot and 5 points out of being the worst team in the NHL. So we're kind of in no man's land.
So, Matt, if I told you there was a young player, a 19-year-old player in the NHL, who this week got 4 goals in 1 game and 6 goals in 3 games, do you think he'd be the first star of the week?
I would automatically assume so, yes.
If I told you it's Sam Bennett and he was the second star of the week, what would you think?
Who did what to take the first spot?
He's in good companies with, what, Patrick Kane and Kopitar.
Yeah.
But, you know, the way I look at it is Chicago doesn't need, you know, like, yes, you know, there's 7 points. It's Kane, right, who got number one? You know, Kane got 7 points, but Chicago's already number one. Those 7 points don't mean as much as, you know, they do to a young 19-year-old fighting for the playoffs. So if we're just going by pure numbers, okay, I can understand it. But to me, there almost needs to be a storyline thrown in here. What do those points mean to that team? In Chicago, someone else would have got those points. Like, they have an 11-game win streak. They're not having a problem finding points.
No, and Kane got 4 goals and 3 assists, which, I don't know. To me, assists are not as important as goals. And to be beat out by 1 point and having 2 fewer goals, I don't know. Like, unless Kane's goals were all game winners, that would be the only way I could see him legitimately taking the top honors. I don't know. I just don't see that as being a viable thing, like, especially because a player scoring 4 goals in 1 game is so rare.
It's so rare. That almost deserves it right there. You know, and I don't know. Maybe we're, you know, we're biased because we're Flames fans. We're looking at it one way. But, yeah, to me, I say, you know, he's got 6 goals. You're right. Kane had some assists in there. And, you know, really, if we look at the standings, a goal and assist are worth the same. But I agree with you. The guy who gets the glory is the guy who got the goal. So I'm surprised when I saw the stats today that Bennett was number two. I thought, wow, he got robbed.
Yeah, same here. That was my initial reaction. But
and I bet if we go back and look, Kane's been star of the week lots. You know, like I bet, you know, the NHL could have thrown this one to Bennett. It would have meant a lot more to him, and really wouldn't have meant anything to Kane's career.
Oh no. Well, Kane's gonna likely win the Hart Trophy anyway. So what's the difference?
So, yeah, I'm surprised because just looking on paper, you know, with the week Sam Bennett has had, he really looks like he should have won it. Like, you know, to me, there's no doubt in my mind.
Yeah. Oh, well, not much you can do.
Looking at the week Sam Bennett's had, I mean, yeah, we can say he had a great week. He did. There's no denying that. But I don't think that we can expect him to score on this kind of pace for the rest of the year.
No.
But it is showing us that Sam Bennett really is the real deal. You know, this guy is, I think, the Flames' future number one centerman.
If not number one, he'll be number two. It'll depend on who develops in our system. And, like, if the Flames are having a high draft pick again, who we take and all that. Because if the Flames, say they get, say, Matthew Tkachuk, who's a very good left winger, he's supposed to be in the top five, then you could have Monahan with Gaudreau just for size reasons, and then Tkachuk with Bennett as the secondary unit, even though you'd basically be treating both of those as like a first line.
With, let's say we did do that, if we brought in Tkachuk and we have Bennett, both guys can play left wing, would you try to convert one of them to a right wing where we have some need?
Not really. I think Bennett long-term's going to be a center. So I think that, like, if the Flames did draft Tkachuk, then I would see him remaining as a left winger and just move Bennett to the center.
Yeah, I think it's good we have flexibility with Bennett, but I agree with you. I would keep Bennett at center and Tkachuk at left wing. And like you said, it's nice to have two scoring lines if you can count on them instead of always having, you know, your one big scoring line. It's a lot harder to defend if we have two lines that can score. And I think Ben is still a couple years away from being that fully elite player, but I think, you know, Monahan is the guy for now, and I think there will be a time in the next couple years where those guys might be doing equal numbers every year, which would be great.
And you never know. Like, the Flames could end up fluking out and getting Austin Matthews, in which case you have two good centers in Monahan and Matthews, and then you could just leave Bennett as the winger. So it really will depend on where the Flames end up and all that fun stuff. So,
well, I think it also gives us some interesting options, too, because the way I'm seeing Monahan sort of evolving is, being with Goodrow, I see Monahan more evolving into the playmaker than the sniper. And I'm seeing Bennett's role being the sniper on line two. So I think it gives you some interesting pieces you can move around. It's not like we have two clones of the same guy on, you know, our 1-2 center right now.
True enough.
So too bad he didn't get the first star of the week, but Sam, keep playing awesome, and I'm sure next time, if you can put up this performance, you'll be star number one.
And I find it surprising that he's got 6 goals in the last 3 games, and yet the season to date, he only had 5. So he's already more than doubled his goal output for the year.
Yeah, and I know. I was looking at that. I'm like, wow, this guy's really putting up the numbers now. He's making up for lost time. And if we take a look, he has 42 games played. We're just at the midpoint now. 11 goals, 9 assists for 20 total points. So not quite the production we're expecting from this guy, but we have to remember he's still in his rookie year. He played 1 regular season game last year. So he's really, you know, he's almost scoring almost one point every 2 games. And that's not bad. You know, we don't need him to be the number one guy right now.
Yeah, well, like, if you look at Monahan's rookie year, he only had like 34 points or something like that. As long as Bennett's over that by a couple, then, because the Flames have more talent than that team did, I think that would be fine. Like, if he's in the 35 to 40 range, that's perfectly acceptable in my mind.
Yeah, I think Bennett's numbers are good comparables. If we look at Bennett in 2013-2014, he played 75 games for the Flames and had 34 points, and that was a terrible team. He had a minus 20. The next season in 2014-2015, he played 81 games and almost doubled. He had 62 points. So I think if we can see, you know, that kind of production from Bennett, we'll be very happy next year as well.
Yeah, and realistically, the Flames will need to have that kind of output in order for Calgary to progress into becoming a playoff caliber, like, contender style team in a year or two.
Yeah, for sure. But I think it's nice that we can give these guys a little bit less pressure now, you know, especially a guy like Bennett, who maybe needs a couple years to develop at the NHL level, and we can give him that in a lower pressure scenario.
Mm-hmm. Oh, and speaking of Ryan Nugent-Hopkins, this just came out. He was injured in the Panthers game and will be out for a long time, so possibly like a month or so. He hurt his hand. So much for any trade involving him.
Now Torelli's got to wish he'd move the kid. Wow. Yeah, that sucks. They've got 2 of their best players out now in Edmonton.
Now they just need... Yeah, it's a broken hand, so... Now they just need Draisaitl to get hurt, and they won't have any centers.
They'll be looking around, shopping for centers, and maybe we can give them one for a good deal. Another Flames player we talked about him earlier, it's looking good, is Jonas Hiller. Hiller's been given his 3rd consecutive nod. He'll play tomorrow night against the Devils. How long do you think he plays for? Do you think they'll kind of play him until he doesn't look good? Do you think they're just trying to rest Ramo, and as soon as he says he's ready, they'll throw him in? What do you think the strategy is here?
I think that we might see a return to last season's play until you're playing badly, and then the other guy will get back in. I think with Ramo playing 30 of the 43 games to date, you want to see him get a little bit of rest. He's not used to that kind of a workload. So if Hiller plays well against New Jersey, there's no reason not to start him in the next one. And you just carry on and hope that if Hiller does falter, that Ramo can step back in and play as effectively as he did prior to taking a couple days off.
Yeah, and I think that, you know, we saw Bob Hartley early in the season almost lose confidence in Hiller. He almost seemed like he only had one goaltender. I mean, even in back-to-backs, we were playing only one goalie. And I think that Hiller's play recently has put some confidence back. I wouldn't be surprised to see Hiller play every game on the road trip except for one of the back-to-backs. And I think that this gives Hartley options, like you said. You know, we have some back-to-backs coming up. We have one this month, one in February. We have a couple of them coming in March. I think that Romo's definitely going to get the majority of the starts from here on out, but I wouldn't be surprised if Jonas Hiller is the starter for this road trip.
Wouldn't surprise me either. And he played well enough.
He's starting against New Jersey. He'll probably start against Columbus, and I can see them starting him against the Kings.
And if he plays well, then he'll get more of an opportunity. If he doesn't, then you have a guy that's been playing really good for most of the season ready to go. So either way, we'll see. And we won't know really until we get there. And Hiller has the track record of being able to play well, so hopefully he can continue to at least play well through at the trade deadline or beyond.
Well, and you were mentioning earlier that this could be Hiller's last go around in the NHL. And if I look at our two goaltenders, I think that if any one of them needs to prove themselves right now, it's Jonas Hiller. I think that somebody next year, whether it's us or somebody else, will look at Romo and say, this guy's a viable option. Maybe not as a number one, but maybe as a 1B or a 2. But I think Hiller really right now needs to put up or shut up, or I think he's got a ticket back to playing European hockey next year.
Oh, I can't argue with you.
So it'll be interesting to see how he does there. And, you know, we've seen both goalies rise to the occasion in the past. And, yeah, it'll be interesting to see Hiller. But it's been kind of fun to see his gold shield in the net again. Hiller's always had such interesting masks. Even though they've been black, I've always thought the gold shield he wears is cool. So it's neat to see that back in the net again.
Mm-hmm.
So we're at the midway point in the season. We're at 42 games for the Flames, just pretty much just over the midway point. And if you look right now, the Flames are sitting at 43 points. They're seventh in the Western Conference, which puts them at really a point a game so far. 43 games, 43 points. The only team below us in the West is Edmonton at 41 points. And there's three teams in the East, Buffalo, Toronto, Columbus, also below us. Right now, to get into the playoff picture, we need 48 points to tie Nashville for a wild card or San Jose in the Pacific. Matt, looking around the league, any surprises so far in the first half of the season?
There's not really a huge amount. If you look at the division leaders, seeing Chicago there, that makes sense. Seeing Los Angeles there, that makes sense.
We knew LA had to rebound after last season.
Washington, they've been playing a lot better than I think anyone expected, but to see them tops in their division isn't really a surprise. Florida, that one's a little bit more of a surprise than not, but that whole division's kind of terrible, so.
That's the Atlantic Division?
Yeah, because all of Florida, Detroit, Tampa, Boston, Montreal, Ottawa, they're all really close with each other, and they're not really playing all that well.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at the points there, we've got Florida at 57 points, Detroit at 54, and Tampa Bay at 52. They hold down the three playoff spots for the Atlantic. And both Eastern Conference wildcard teams at this point, Boston at 51 and Montreal at 50, are in the wild card. So we have five Atlantic teams in, you know, the eight playoff spots for the East.
Yeah, and the whole division's kind of terrible. So between now and the end of the year, any of the six teams that are at the top of the division could easily take first place. So that's the only division where the leaders unexpected, and I don't know. The way I look at it, for the true playoff contenders, in my mind, there's only three teams that really stand out, and that's Washington, Los Angeles, and Chicago. And I think whichever of the two Western teams that ends up representing the West in the Cup final will end up taking it.
Yeah, I think the West is the stronger conference this year.
Yeah. And, you know, it really depends. Like, any team can upset another, but with Chicago and LA winning 5 of the last 7 Cups, I don't see any of the other teams in the league really being able to have a claim of being more of a favorite than either of them.
No, I agree. Those guys are the closest thing we have to a dynasty right now.
Mm-hmm.
Any teams you're surprised at the midpoint are sitting in a playoff spot or out of a playoff spot?
Well, there's two teams that I'm somewhat surprised that are outside a playoff spot at the moment, and that's the Pittsburgh Penguins and the Calgary Flames. So I think both teams have underperformed their overall talent levels.
I can agree with you on the Penguins. I think I have a sense the Penguins are going to sneak in. I think they're going to sneak into Montreal's spot as the last Eastern wild card.
I can agree with that.
I think that they're built to be a playoff team, and for them to keep struggling, changes are going to have to be made there more than have been. And I don't know, they're built to be a playoff team, and I'd be surprised if they don't get in. And if they don't, and they become the LA Kings from last year of this year, I think they're going to come out with a vengeance next year.
Yeah. Well, any team that has Phil Kessel, Sidney Crosby, and Evgeny Malkin and are that bad, that's not going to last.
No, it can't.
Even though, like, the rest of the team might be having difficulties, those three players should be enough to get you a playoff spot, even if you're just the eighth seed.
For sure. I'm not surprised Calgary's sitting outside. I was not all that optimistic about playoffs coming into the year. I am, however, surprised that Anaheim is sitting outside the playoffs and Arizona is sitting in the playoffs.
Yeah, I can agree with that, too.
Arizona this year was supposed to be the, you know, the team chasing Edmonton for the bottom of the league. And I think Arizona is the Calgary Flames of last year for this season. They're that team that's made up of guys that weren't supposed to do much, and they've had good bounces and good luck, and, you know, somehow they're in the playoffs. And again, Anaheim is a team that is built, like Pittsburgh, to be a playoff team, and they're struggling.
Well, Anaheim, I have no idea why they're struggling as much as they are. Offensively, they're by far the worst team in the league. Defensively, they've only allowed 105 goals, which is actually fairly good. There's only LA in the Western Conference, and Washington and Florida in the Eastern Conference have surrendered fewer goals. So there's no reason why they've struggled as badly. They only lost Matt Bolesky from last year offensively.
Well, that's it. Their roster hasn't changed much. It's not like it's a new roster. It's been retooled. You know, Cogliano, Getzlaf, Kessler, these guys, Perry, these guys have been there forever.
I know. It's just
so
bizarre.
What's the difference?
Yeah, like, they did trade Emerson Edom for Carl Hagelin, and subsequently Hagelin was dealt this week for David Perron. But none of the, like, they should not be as bad overall offensively as they have been. And if they figure that out, I'm assuming that they will be a playoff team. Like, I could even see the Flames trading Yuri Hudler to Anaheim at the deadline if the Flames are in full seller mode. But I don't know. It's just weird how some teams can struggle. I would have said the same thing about Los Angeles last year, though.
And if you look at a team like Arizona, who was one of the biggest sellers last year, I think that they could be one of the biggest buyers trying to hold off a team like Anaheim for a playoff spot this year. I agree that I think the Flames and the Ducks might do a deal, and I think if the Ducks don't make the playoffs, they might be doing a retooling over the summer.
If not, I think they might just fire the coach and go with somebody else first before. Because you got to figure that Perry, Getzlaf, and Kessler are going to be under contract for a long time. So I think you would try to figure some way of making it work with those guys. And
yeah, I don't know. I figure if they were going to get rid of the coach, they would have done that by now.
True. We'll see.
I don't know the market in Anaheim as much, but most of those sort of hot weather markets, if you will, tend to be very short term. And I think it might be, you know, okay, let's move one of our big guys to shake things up. But we'll see. I mean, you're right. It's going to be tough contracts to move. Those guys are going to be under long-term deals.
Yeah, and if they do miss the playoffs, they're going to get a good draft pick out of the deal. So they have Richie coming up. So if they get another quality guy, they can kind of rebuild on the fly. So we'll see. And sometimes teams just have really bad years. Like, I'm always reminded of the Flyers a handful of years ago when the year that they got Van Riemsdyk. And they look like a legit cup contender and yet finished second worst overall.
That's true. Yeah, and that's where you got to look at what's happened here and what kind of retooling do we need. And I think sometimes it's just the coach gets long in the tooth, or maybe there's, you know, issues in the room. So you got to look into it and say, what caused this for 1 year? Because Anaheim has the talent.
Yeah. And, like, even if you look at the Flames, like, if they didn't have as bad of a first month, even if they only won two or three more games than they did, we're right in the playoff picture. And, you know, or in a playoff spot. And, you know, one little stretch of not playing so well, and it completely derailed the Flames season to this point. So, we'll see.
Looking at the other teams in the playoffs and looking at where you think the Flames might make it. Well, let's start there. If the Flames make the playoffs, what spot do you think they'll hold? Do you think they'll have one of the three Pacific Division spots, or do you think they'll have a wild card spot?
I honestly don't see any of the Pacific Division teams holding a wild card spot. I think that it's going to be like last year, where there's only three teams from our division in the playoffs.
So if we get the third spot against San Jose and you look at the Pacific Division, do you think the Flames have any chance of making it past round one?
The only team that I could see realistically beating Calgary in round one would be Anaheim. I think that if they played Vancouver, that they could manage. San Jose, they could manage. Arizona would be a little tough, but it's possible. But Anaheim, I think that you would literally see a repeat of the playoffs from last year. Five games and done.
And if you look ahead to, say, round two or three, do you think this Flames team is built to go, let's say, even three rounds?
No, I don't see us getting past LA. If we do get past the first round, we're not going to beat LA.
Looking at how inconsistent the Flames have been as well, I think we would be lucky to string together, you know, 4 of 7 in one round, much less 4 of 7 in two rounds.
I can't argue with that. The Flames this year have been so inconsistent from game to game, period to period, week to week. Who knows? Like, they do have it in them. We saw in the Florida game, or the Colorado game, or even the Tampa game from this month, where they can beat anybody. It's just doing that with any semblance of consistency. Like we saw against Edmonton, they came out like world beaters in the first period. It looked like it was going to be another 6-0 game, and instead they just shut off entirely in the second and third period, and that was it.
Yeah, I think if you're playing the same game, or the same team, I should say, who plays pretty much the same game most teams over and over, you know, 4 times, 5 times, 6 times, or 7 times in a row, I think other teams will be able to get into Calgary's head and render them ineffective.
And that's quite possible. At this point, if the Flames don't make the playoffs, I'm not really concerned. Like, especially if you look at this year's draft, there is nine guys that are at the top end of the draft that are all pretty dynamite players. So if Calgary does miss, I don't see us finishing out of the top 10. So if they do struggle and miss, they're going to get one of those guys. And 7 of those 9 players are either right wingers or defensemen. And they're all, with the exception of Nylander, are 6'2 or taller. So that would help to address the size issues and all that fun stuff.
So if I look at the Flames' first half, and you give me your thoughts on their first half after, but if I look at their first half, I think we're seeing who the Calgary Flames really are. Last year, we saw a team that was getting lucky. They were getting good bounces. They were having a lot of luck. They were not a team that, on paper, should have been a playoff team last year, and I think we got caught up in that hype coming into this year. I talked about this in the offseason. I don't think we need the playoffs to have a successful year. It's about building young players. What I'm hoping is that if and when we are out, we move veterans for picks. We, you know, start bringing in draft picks. And in their spots of those veterans, we're promoting young guys. We really haven't seen the number of bodies wear a Flames jersey this year as we did last year because the league is so tight and we still might be in this. But I think even if we don't make the playoffs, we can still classify this as a successful year of growth.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, to me, Johnny Gaudreau is looking like one of the best players in the league. We're seeing the growth of Bennett. You know, we're seeing even TJ Brody, you know, in top form. We're seeing Hamilton coming around as a Flame. So I think this can still be a successful year without making a postseason appearance.
Oh, for sure. And anytime you're in a rebuilding situation, you're going to have ups and downs. And last year it was mostly ups. This year we're getting some downs. Calgary has way too much money tied up in players that are just there. And we're going to see some of those players be moved out this year. And we're going to see even more at either the trade deadline or at the end of next season. So we'll see. I think that if the Flames do go into seller mode, that it wouldn't be a bad thing if they dealt 8 or 9 players off the team and, you know, use guys from the farm, because guys like Drew Shore, Derek Grant, Emile Poirier, Kenny Agostino, Bill Arnold, all those guys could easily fill spots for the last month of the season if the Flames do go into complete seller mode.
I mean, if you look at this team compared to last year's team, as far as the names on the roster and the numbers on the jerseys go, really the only difference between this year and last year's team is Michael Frolik's been added and Dougie Hamilton's been
exactly.
added.
Exactly. And there's not been any Matt Beleski-type deletions with Anaheim that you could say, oh, that ruined the team.
No, but I think that next year, though, if we look at this roster coming out of training camp before opening day in the 2016-2017 team, I think we're going to see a very different-looking Calgary Flames team.
And I think we're going to, especially if the Flames do sell off, like guys that are UFA, Russell, the goalies, one of them at least, Jones, Hudler, even if they just sell off, those guys, you have to replace them either internally or externally. So just that would be a big shakeup to the team. And if they go further and sell off guys like Bullig or, say, Weidman or one of the other third-pairing defensemen, Smead or Englund, you could start to really see some active turnover.
Yeah, no, I think you're right. And I'm looking at the roster here and looking at the contracts in this roster. And, yeah, I think that probably the biggest change to the roster that we've seen since the rebuild started, if you will, is going to be this coming year. I think a lot of the veterans that we've amassed, because we needed veterans over time, you know, you have them.
Anytime you're in a rebuild situation, you need guys that can hold the fort, so that way you're not Edmonton where you're needing to plug guys in because of necessity. And as we're looking ahead to next year, a lot of guys are going to need spots, and having a one-month audition for those players would not hurt as well. And you're like one of the arguments that I've heard of not selling off too many players at the deadline is, oh, you're going to lose so much experience. But you can easily sign guys in on July 1st or trade for them at the draft to replace what you've dealt as well.
Yeah, and for all we know, I mean, you know, we might have one of these guys who thinks the grass is going to be greener on the other side. Let's say Chris Russell thinks he can get a ton of money, can't, and ends up coming back to Calgary after July 1st at a very reasonable deal. And I'd be happy to have him back if we could get him at a reasonable deal.
Yeah, but I wouldn't want to hang on to, like, if the Flames are out of it, I wouldn't want to hang on to him just because he's from Alberta. And, like, we can use the draft pick for something. And if he
that's
wants
the old
Daryl
Sutter mentality. He's an Alberta boy. He's got to stay.
Yeah. And if we can get a draft pick for him and on July 1st he wants to come back, fine. Awesome. You know, it wouldn't want to deal him just to deal him. But unless he signs beforehand, then there's no point. And if the Flames are out of it, I don't really see the point of signing him either. You know what I mean?
Yeah, and like I think going into UFA with some holes is not a bad thing either, because, you know, then we can pick up the guys that we need. You know, if we look at a Michael Frolik, we said there's a very specific type of player we need, a right winger who played a certain type of game, and we were able to find the guy we needed. So even if we do an audition of young players and we say, we don't have quite what we need, it gives us time to shop for that. Instead of trying to trade an asset and see what's available, we can go shopping a little bit more in the offseason with a better knowledge of what we have or what we don't.
Yeah, and say the Flames do finish in the bottom five, and say we get Lane or Puljujarvi or Nylander or Tkachuk or whatever. If you're a UFA, you're looking at Calgary. They have three really good defensemen in Hamilton, Brody, and Giordano. They have Gaudreau, they have Monahan, they have Bennett, and this new draft pick. Like, that, you look at that team as a whole, and you can see that they're on the way
up. I want to be part of that.
Yeah, like a guy like, say, Kyle Okposo might go, hey, this team's going to be pretty good. I'm a right winger. They need a right winger. I can go play with Johnny Gaudreau. Hey, awesome. Sign me up.
Yeah, no, and I think that's a lot of what happened with Hudler when he left Detroit. He said, here's a team that's upcoming. I want to be part of it.
Yeah, and like even if you look at Frolik, that, I'm sure that was one of the reasons why he did sign with Calgary. And
yeah,
you need to have some enticing assets to your organization to get you to sign a UFA, because if you didn't, then why are you going to sign, other than money, why are you going to sign?
We have Mason Raymond.
Oh, gee. Yeah, I forgot.
That'll bring anybody here.
Yeah.
Raymond brings the big dogs to the yard.
Yep. But, you know, Calgary does look like a team that in 3 or 4 years will be either a cup favorite or a cup winner.
Yeah.
So, you know, you want to get in on the basement floor of that.
And really, if you look, pretty much every forward, except for Raymond, over the age of 30 is going to be gone by the end of next year, probably even Raymond after next year. So I wouldn't be surprised to see the Flames pick up somebody a little bit older than Frolik, maybe a 28, 29-year-old who has that experience, can be that veteran, and going forward transitions into that, you know, over 30 veteran spot.
Yeah, sort of like Yuri Hudler when we got Yuri Hudler.
Yeah, exactly. A guy who, if he can play top 6 minutes, great. Or, I mean, top 3 minutes, great, but has to be able to play top 6 minutes, because as he gets older, you want to be able to drop him down to that second line.
Yep, exactly.
Any other thoughts on the Flames before we move on?
No, just hopefully they have a good road trip this week and next, and not seeing them fall down into Columbus territory by the time that we talk next.
Any Flames that at the halfway point now have disappointed you?
Only Yuri Hudler, but that I have a sneaking suspicion that he's been dealing with his groin problem all year, because he's looked off all year. So other than that, like, even Monahan, he's been not as good, but young players do have ups and downs, so I'm not really surprised. Other than that, not really. The whole team's been a little off. Like, Weidman's been a little off, but he's still in his career norms, so...
I agree with you about Yuri Hudler. I think, and we've talked about this earlier in the year, I think he's dealing with an injury that we didn't know about at the beginning of the year. The guys that have really disappointed me so far, one of them is Brandon Bolig.
Yeah, I can agree with that.
You know, even if you look last year, I think Bolig had more of a useful role with the team.
Yeah, and I think this now, he's just there.
He just seems to be a body, and when he's on the ice, he doesn't seem like he does anything. And even if you look at guys in his position in the past, you know, even a guy like Brian McGrattan, who had some offensive skill, and Bolig just seems like he's a big body doing nothing. So he surprised me. I'm not necessarily surprised by it, but a little bit disappointed that we've seen a drop-off in performance from Josh Juris.
Yeah.
I was really expecting, after Juris surprised us, that he was going to stay as a, you know, sort of third-line centerman. And I think that if I was management and the coach, I'd be looking at him as a replaceable asset right now.
I can agree with that. And we have to see more from him if he's going to remain, because we do have guys like Poirier, Bill Arnold, and all the other guys I mentioned earlier that are also pushing for spots. So if he doesn't start playing well, he might be on the outside looking in next year.
On the flip side, is there anyone that's really impressed you so far? Oh, before we move on, you mentioned Monahan as sort of a disappointment. I think Monahan's transitioned to a new role. I think his production might be down, but I think it's because they're trying to play him in a bit of a different game. So I want to give him a year or two to shake out at his new position.
Yeah, and that's why, like, yes, his numbers are slightly down from last year. I think he's only, like, 6 or 7 points off, if that, from last year.
But I also don't think Goudreau would be as dynamic if not for Monahan there.
No, and having a very responsible defensive center in Monahan, it allows Goudreau to pull all the crazy stuff that he does. So,
mm-hmm.
I'm not really minding how things are going. Like, especially, like, Monahan needs to evolve into Jonathan Toews, and where he's a shutdown two-way center. And for Calgary to win the Stanley Cup, he needs to be that leader that can go play against the other team's top lines and just shut them down. And
yeah, I agree with you.
You can't have him being the flashy, super dynamic offensive guy. And, like, if we're drawing comparables to Chicago, like, Gaudreau's Patrick Kane, we need him to be that secondary guy, and hopefully Bennett can be a good secondary scorer as well.
I think we put Monahan into that scoring role because we needed him there when he first came in. It's what we needed. And I think now we can kind of step back and say, hey, we really need you to be sort of the
overall,
not really second fiddle, but we need you to be in the supporting scoring role here.
Yeah. If you can score, great, but we need you to first focus on defense.
You're the centerman we needed for Jerome.
Yes, exactly.
Anyone that's really surprised you this year on a good side? Anyone who, you know, you weren't expecting a lot of and we've seen a lot of?
Honestly, not really. Like, I expected Gaudreau to be as good as he has been. I've been making comparisons between TJ Brody and Scott Niedermayer for at least a year now, so I can't really say that what he's doing is shocking me. So, no, I think that the guys that are performing at a very high level were kind of expected to do so.
I'll give you two guys I'm a bit surprised with. One is our captain, number 5. I thought that after another big injury last year, he wouldn't be the same. I was expecting Giordano to take a bit of a backseat to Hamilton this year.
Yeah.
I wasn't expecting him to be, you know, 5'6" guy, but I thought we might see him drop down to a 3'4" guy, especially after such a big injury, and it's not the first one in his career. So I'm really glad to see that he's sticking around and playing the game the way he used to. The other guy I'm surprised about is Kari Ramo. I mean, we forget, but this guy got sent to the AHL earlier in the year. So from a goaltender who lost favor, who got sent to the farm, and has carried this team on his back since, if you would have asked me at the beginning of the year, I would not have said that Ramo was probably sometimes going to be single-handedly the best Flame on the ice.
Yeah, I can agree with that, especially after last year when I don't really remember any game that he stole. And yet, this year, he has on multiple occasions.
The fact that Ramo signed a one-year deal in the offseason, I think even management was thinking, this guy's good enough for now. You know, I think when he signed that one-year deal, I don't know about you, I thought, okay, they're signing him as a backup. And, you know, they'll use him for a year, and maybe Ordeo will take over. And if we lose him on waivers, no big deal, because Ordeo's the guy. I think that Ramo has earned himself, whether it's here or somewhere else, another NHL contract.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I agree wholeheartedly. It'll be interesting to see what the Flames do with him and whether they sign him, they trade him, or they sign him again in the offseason. Who knows? I think that the only potential alternate would be Cam Ward from Carolina as a UFA, and even then, in either case, it would be just a temporary holding the fort down until Gillies or McDonald are ready.
Yeah, I don't see a better option internally. I think the Flames have lost faith in Ordeo. Poulin's not the guy.
Yeah, and realistically, so I don't see Ordeo coming back. And with how he's been playing in Stockton, I wouldn't even offer him a contract.
No, and I mean, you know, I don't think there's any way that we get Jonas Hiller back. So I think you're right. We might see a guy like Cam Ward as that sort of, okay, good enough for a couple years until we get out of the rebuild and we get our big, whether that's through our system or through a big trade, until we find that new young goaltender.
And that will be determined basically once how either Gillies or McDonald play at the NHL level. If they steal the job, then it's theirs. If not, then in like two seasons from now, then I think the Flames will look to deal for one of the new upcoming guys, like how Toronto acquired Bernier, or the Sharks with Jones, or, you know, insert team there. You know what I mean, so.
Yeah, I think that's going to be the next position that the Flames, not necessarily right now, but I think that's going to be the next big position the Flames have to address. We saw them address defense throughout the system this year, and I think goalies next.
Two to three years from now, though. Not anytime soon, but.
Yeah, but I think they have to start looking at what are we going to do, what pieces would be available, and even looking at, you know, what's going to be available in rounds 2, 3, 4 in a draft to potentially bring somebody in there. Because as you start moving guys, you know, like McDonald goes pro next year, probably, you're going to need other, you know, guys behind him.
Yeah, because currently we only have Schneider that will be in juniors beyond next season. So you're going to have to look at, okay, well, we will need yet another goalie. And I think realistically you have to draft one guy each year until you get your Kiprusoff-level talent.
Yeah, so I think that'll be the next position of interest here in Calgary.
And realistically, there's nobody that's going to be drafted in the first round likely this year for goalies, so we're looking at more second, third round or beyond. And if the Flames do sell at the deadline, that will be flush with secondary picks, so options will be available if in the second and third round.
And I could also see them flipping a pick for a goaltender as
Yes, same, sort of like with Talbot and the Oilers last year, or Leonard and Buffalo, that kind of thing.
Exactly. You take somebody's backup, like, I think Talbot's a great example. You take someone's backup who's not seen a lot of time, but who you think has some potential. I mean, remember, Kiprusoff was a third stringer.
Yeah, or like the Rangers with Antti Raanta, who's a UFA. That would be one of my targets as well, so.
I could see us going after Raanta for sure. I think he'd be a better option than Ward would be. Well, we've talked a little bit about some of the guys in Stockton. Why don't we look at the Stockton Heat? It's been a little while since we've taken a look at the Heat. Matt has been following most of the games, and the Heat have been struggling, I'd say, worse than the Calgary Flames have this year.
It's interesting. The team seems to lack all the all their confidence when Yanni Ordio's in net, and like one of his last starts, he gave up 6 goals in the game, and the first goal and the second goal weren't necessarily bad goals, but the team was just playing so poorly in front of him, and then it kind of just snowballed from there. And sort of like what happened in October with all of the goaltenders, the team just seemed to be on edge, not wanting to make a mistake, and which leads to more mistakes, and then you get a 6-0 score. Yet when Kevin Poulin, who returned a few days ago, when he's in net, the team plays normal, and they don't necessarily win every game, but they play more of their game, and they play well enough to collect victories.
And we're seeing that the Heat do have offensive talent. You know, like even if you look in the last week, I mean, on January 13th with Poulin in net, the Heat picked up a 6-2 win over the Rampage. As you mentioned, on January 16th, they were in Rockford. They lost 3-0. And then on January 17th, the next night, it was a 7-4 win for the Heat. So when they get going, when they get hot, if you will, they do have the offensive talent. Looking at the roster, they should be scoring that, you know, 6, 5, 6, 7 goals a night.
You would think that based off the Heat being the worst team in the Pacific Division with a 14-16-1-1 record, that they're not a good team, or none of the players are NHL caliber guys, but the Flames could easily recall Kenny Agostino, Derek Grant, Drew Shore, Emile Poirier, Bill Arnold, and stick them in up front. And
I think even Freddie Hamilton.
I forgot about him. Yes, him as well. And none of them are going to be great NHL talents, at least for this year. But if you look at how a guy like Marcus Granlund or Josh Juris, that's basically the level of their play at this point. Like, they could play at the NHL level at roughly what they're doing. Not going to blow you away, but they can play solidly at both ends and not really hurt the club too much.
Well, we liked what we saw from Derek Grant earlier in the year when he got recalled. I think he might be at the same point that we saw Granlund at, where he's not really benefiting much from the AHL, but they just need to find a spot for him in the NHL.
I think if the Flames do sell off like 4 or 5 forwards, you would see him for sure, plus a few other guys. On the back end, there's really only 3 guys that are playing well, and that's Brett Kulak. He's been somewhat inconsistent, which is what you would expect for a guy his age. Oliver Shillington, who's been pretty much dynamite offensively all season, still a work in progress defensively, has some games where he's worse than others. Oh, yeah.
But he's young, too, and, you know, I think it's going to take a couple years for him to get that consistency.
The offensive talent there is top-notch, and once he gets a little older, a lot more experience, he'll be a dynamite NHL talent. And Jakub Nakladl, who he could slot in as the number 5 right now, and you wouldn't notice any difference. That's why I think the Flames might end up trading not just Russell, but either Weidman, Smead, or England, depending on what the return is at the deadline, because Nakladl could just slot in, and there wouldn't be any problems.
Well, and Nikolodl is a free agent at the end of the year, too. So I think we need to decide if he's someone we want to keep around or if he's someone that, you know, we let go after 1 year, almost like a David Wolf or, you know, any of those guys we bring over for a year and say, no,
I think
no, thank
that
you.
He has enough talent where he could be a good number 5-6 guy for the Flames for 2 or 3 or 4 years beyond this season. So I think that moving a couple of defensemen out would not necessarily be a bad thing, and you could throw him, even a guy like Tyler Watherspoon, who's just been okay at the AHL level this year.
I think Watherspoon's past expiry date with this organization. I think that there's a lot of guys that passed him on the depth chart.
I think that you would give him a shot at the NHL level. Like, say you trade 2 or 3 of the defensemen, I think you bring him up just to see if he can magically turn it on at the NHL level. If not, then you just walk
away.
See,
I think I'd bring up Nikolodl and Kulak.
I could agree with that as well. But you would like to, especially using a second round pick on a guy, I'd rather see him be given that one last shot. And if not, then you know, okay, you don't have to worry about him and just carry on.
One of the guys I've been curious about, and you can tell us how he's looked, is Emil Poirier. I know he had a rough start to the season. How's he looking at this point?
He's still learning how to play an NHL-type game. And when he played last year in the NHL for the 6 games, he was trying to play the same game that he did in juniors, and that was not very effective. I think he only had 1 point in the NHL last year. He's been trying to adapt his game so that way he can generate offense not only off the rush, which that was how he generated offense in juniors. So he's learning where to be in the offensive zone. He's still having ups and downs. He only has 6 goals in 30 games and 17 points overall. It hasn't been the easiest season for him, but he's learning, and that's what the AHL is all about. Most guys are not Johnny Gaudreau or Sean Monahan, where they can just step into the NHL and be awesome right from day one. Usually it takes 4 or 5 seasons post-draft to establish yourself as a quality player. He's still good, and I expect him to be a second, third line player in the NHL. It'll take some time.
I think we've got very fortunate that we've had guys who could step in as quickly as they have, and I think that we're forgetting that for most players, there is that development curve.
Well, you look at a guy like Michael Backlund. How long did it take him to cement himself as a legitimate NHL talent?
Yeah.
And that's more the traditional way for players.
Even a guy like Sven Berchi.
Yeah, and even he's still inconsistent, and it's been since 2010, so 5 years since he was drafted, and he's still not a consistent producer at the NHL level. So it takes a while.
I'm glad to see Freddie Hamilton as the third highest point getter in the Heat when we acquired him. I thought it was really just a favor to his brother, and he was going to probably get sent to the ECHL. But I'm glad to see that he's actually becoming a good talent here.
Yeah, I wouldn't be entirely surprised if in a year or two he actually cracks the Flames lineup and is an actual player for the Flames. I wouldn't expect him to be more than a fourth line player, but stranger things have happened.
I'm also happy to see Kenny Agostino turning his game around. He's the second highest point getter right now. He's been pretty consistent all year. And, you know, for a guy who came in such a monumental trade, he was part of the Aginla trade. I'm glad to see that there's something there.
Mm-hmm.
Again, I think he might be one of these, bottom three, maybe even 13th forwards. I don't think Agostino is going to last a long time in the NHL, but I think he will definitely get himself a look there.
Yeah, and that's one of the situations when you're drafting, like, say, a guy like Andrew Mangiapane, right? He's doing really good in the Ontario Hockey League, one of the top scorers in that league. But when he develops, he might only be Paul Byron. So you need good players at all levels, and a guy like Kenny Agostino might only top out as a third, fourth line guy for a couple of seasons. A guy like Mark Arcobello, using an Oilers reference, and just somebody that can bounce around the league, play a quality third, fourth line role, not particularly noteworthy to keep long term, but just a solid overall player.
The guy I always like to compare in that role is Jamie Lundmark.
Yeah, perfect.
Lundmark always seemed to have a job. Everybody wanted him, but he never stayed in one place for very long.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and if you're looking at the defensive version of that, would be Adam Clendenning, who's on his fourth team in, I think, a year and a bit. So, just a solid overall guy. Everybody could use a guy like him, but he's not good enough where, oh, I must keep this guy for 8 years.
Yeah, I think even a guy like former Flame Adam Partey is that way too, where, you know, he'll get a contract, and when that contract's up, there's no urgency to renew him, but somebody will renew him.
Exactly.
You know, he's with the Jets now, and that's up. I can't see them going out saying, we really need Partey. It'll be, let's bring up the next young guy. But, you know, maybe Dallas or somebody will take him.
Mm-hmm. Anybody who's needing a solid number six with size.
Mm-hmm. If I look down the Flames farm roster right now in Stockton, I see a lot of guys who I think are going to be in that role, who are going to be in the NHL for a long time. Maybe not superstars or maybe not in a Flames jersey, but who are going to be in the National Hockey League, you know, in a bottom six role for a while. I think we're going to have a lot of those guys come out of our system.
Mm-hmm. And if you look at another player that some people have been wondering about, Morgan Klimchuk, he's only got 6 points in 24 games this season. He's being groomed as a good defensive player, and even though he's not been particularly good at generating offense, for a team that's bad, he's only actually a minus one. And he is being played primarily as a defensive forward. So the Flames are trying to groom him into that quality, sort of like a Michael Backlund on the wing type of guy. Where, because you know that he can score, and he has that kind of offensive talent. He's being brought up to try and force him into being that really dynamite defensive player.
And I think it's hard sometimes too, when you are, you know, a bad team, to really evaluate the quality of these guys. You know, like even we say with the Oilers, right? Is they're a terrible team, and they obviously as a group are not meshing together. They're not doing the best they can. So I think as much as we might see a guy like Poirier struggling or like Klimchuk struggling, I think we need to give this team a year where they're not a bottom team to really evaluate some talent here.
Mm-hmm.
It's, I think, unfair to make decisions about some of those guys, especially some of our young prospects, you know, with this year as our reference.
Mm-hmm. And if you, especially if you're looking at Stockton as a whole, they don't really have a lot of veteran talent on the team. And usually the teams that are in the top portion of the AHL standings, they're basically all veteran guys with like five or six young guys. And Calgary just simply has too many quality prospects to be able to have five or six veteran forwards, five or six veteran goaltenders or defensemen. So that also makes a huge difference.
Yeah, and I wouldn't be surprised. I don't think we're going to see it this year, but I think maybe next year and the year after, where you're going to see, similar to the Max Reinhardt deal, we're going to see the Flames looking at some of these assets, saying it's a good asset, but it's not for us. And, you know, trying to move some of those young players, either in a package or for a draft pick, and just trying to replenish that group with new, fresh pieces.
Yeah, and if you look at the last two drafts, the Flames have selected fewer players than the amount of rounds in the draft. So we're going to need some veteran guys in, like, say, two seasons from now, once those guys come up, because of the fact that we just don't have the amount of roster spots as well. Mm-hmm. So I wouldn't be surprised if Stockton becomes one of the better teams as things progress because of that.
Yeah, and I also think that if you look, Stockton's one of the younger teams. I mean, if you look at the players that have cleared waivers and been sent to the AHL, we have some of the least veteran leadership down there, and I think, you know, that might change next year too. If we see a guy like England or Raymond get sent down to make room for somebody, we might have a little bit more veteran talent down there, which might help as mm-hmm. well. Well, Matt, anything else you want to talk about, or should we play the prediction game?
Let's head to the prediction game.
All right, so our weekly predictions, as always, are brought to you by TickTick. TickTick connects the sea of red to buy and sell tickets securely from their phones. TickTick lets sellers sell for free and verifies the sellers so buyers don't get ripped off when buying tickets. Tickets are delivered digitally, so there's no hassle in trying to pick them up, trying to meet somebody around the city, you know, all that hassle that goes into buying tickets. You can download TickTick now in the Google Play Store or the iOS App Store. We're on a bit of a road trip, but as soon as this team gets back here, we all need to be packing that dome, because if this team is going to be, you know, going to the playoffs, they need our support. So as soon as this team comes back at the end of January, on January 27th, let's buy our tickets, go to TickTick, get yourself in the dome, and let's support the Flames. So, Matt, this week, if we take a look, we've got a couple games in the docket. Last week was sort of a slow week, but we have a game against the New Jersey Devils, an early game at 5 p.m. on the 19th. On Thursday, the 21st, we play the Blue Jackets, the Columbus Blue Jackets at 5. And then on Sunday, the 24th, we have a 4 p.m. game against the Carolina Hurricanes. And we'll be back just before the Dallas game on Monday. We have 3 games, 6 possible points. I've already made my prediction, so why don't I go first? Does that work for you?
Sounds like a plan.
I'm going 4 points this week. I think we're going to drop one to the Devils, but I think we're going to beat both the Blue Jackets and the Carolina Hurricanes.
Sounds like a good prediction.
Those are both teams that are struggling right now. I think if we can't beat the Blue Jackets, there's a problem.
Well, I'm actually going to be the ultimate pessimist, and I'm going to say we're going to get shut out 0 points.
Wow.
Yeah. The only game I can actually realistically see us winning is actually New Jersey. And
why is that?
We have this weird problem of the Nationwide Arena in Columbus. And I think the Flames have dropped like their last 9 or 10 games in Columbus. So I don't know if they'll be able to snap that drought for whatever reason. Like, even when Columbus is terrible and the Flames were good, we always seem to find a way to lose in Columbus. So I'm gonna say that streak will continue. Both New Jersey and Carolina have been a lot better of late, and they're just outside the playoffs. I think they're only like 1 and 2 points out of a playoff spot at the moment. So they're winning more so recently, so I think the Flames might struggle against all of them and come out with 0. I'm hoping that you're closer to being correct than I am.
The only thing I'm thinking in the Columbus game is I think this is the first time we've taken on the Blue Jackets since Tortorella's been there.
True.
And we know that there's this bad blood between Tortorella and Hartley, and I can see Tortorella letting his emotions get into it. And perhaps, you know, coaching the team to go out there and just play a little bit rougher and take them off their game.
It's entirely possible. Like, the Flames should, on paper, win that game. So, just because Columbus is the worst team in the NHL, it's just that if it wasn't for us having that streak of being terrible in that building, I would say, like, that would be an automatic 2 points, but
could be
just
right.
Because of where it is. It's sort of like if we were playing the Ducks, it'd be a little leery because of that.
And if we look at last week, we didn't mention it because really nothing happened, but last week the Flames had 4 points on the board. I thought they'd take both games. I thought they would take both the game against the Panthers and the game against the Oilers, and you thought they'd do 2 points and just
actually, it's the other way around. You had 2 points. I had four.
Oh, sorry. You're right. I put these in the wrong category. I thought they'd take Edmonton. You thought they'd take them both. My bad. I put these in the wrong category. And we ended up splitting the difference and got 3 points on the week. So we stay at 2-3 with you leading by a point. No points.
Well, I'm hoping that we don't split the difference this week with us getting 2 points. Like, I'm hoping that you're correct.
At this point, I feel I have to be correct.
Yeah.
You know, like the later
correct
we
get, or better.
The later we get in the season, the more we can't be going a week with no wins. We can't be going a road trip with no wins.
No. And like, if you look at this month, there's 11 games, and I was thinking that we needed to win at least 7 or 8 of those. So that means that of the next 5 games, the Flames need to win either 4 or 5 of them. So it's not really an enviable position to be in, where you're basically needing to win out just to have a decent month. So if not, then the Flames will, especially because February and March are tougher months, it makes it all the more difficult to get into a playoff spot.
So I just counted, and it looks like we have 21 road games left and 18 home games left this season.
Mm-hmm.
So if you looked at the Flames, are generally not doing as well on the road. If we do want to make the playoffs with how tight we are, we're going to need to be, you know, I think at least 500 on the road going forward.
Mm-hmm.
If we take a look at December, we were 500 on the road.
Yes, and that basically means the Flames are going to have to win 10 or 11 games on the road the rest of the way. We'll see. I'm hopeful that they do that, but, you know, the Flames do have one of the worst road records in the entire NHL, so we'll see.
As long as we keep our head above the Oilers, I'm happy. I think, you know, we can...
Well,
I'm still okay being in the you know, bottom five, but I think as a matter of pride, I want to keep my head above the Oilers.
Yeah. For me, if the Flames miss the playoffs, I hope they finish dead last, to be perfectly honest, because get the worst pick possible, so that way we can hopefully get one of the top players, so that way we're not terrible for long. But either way, like, the one thing that I'd hate the most from a season like this is if the Flames were to finish just, like, 1 point out of a playoff spot and then get, like, the 9th or 10th overall pick.
Mm.
Just because, you know.
Looking at how tight this season is, we could finish 2 points out of the playoffs and still be second last.
True enough. True enough.
You know, I mean, it's such a weird season with the way that the standings are. Who knows what could happen?
True enough.
All right, Matt, we'll enjoy these road games. Remember that they're early games, everybody. So, you know, you might have to listen to them on your drive home from work. You might not be able to fully get home or get to your favorite sports bar. And we will talk to everybody next week. We'll be recording before the Dallas Stars game on the second game of the back-to-back.
Take care, everybody.
Have a good week, Matt.
Bye.
Fireside Chat is hosted by Dan Stevenson, co-hosted by Matt DeBorg. This episode produced and edited by Peter Marino. Fireside Chat is licensed under Creative Commons license. For full license details, visit firesidechat.ca.